Another place you should certainly go, not necessarily tonight, but at some stage, is Wilton's Music Hall. I was amazed when Vanessa said she'd never been. We've been. In fact, we did a whole show from there one time. We did an outside broadcast from Wilton's. But I've also been there to see performances. I've been there and had a tour around it. And it is, I think, one of the most charismatic, just extraordinary buildings in London. I mean, I love the fact that you walk up this kind of tiny little alley, you wouldn't know it's there, and then you go through a door. And it's as if you've gone through time travel as you enter this building. It's splendidly decaying, but thankfully also splendidly going to survive because it's managed to get through the worst, partly down to the person sitting opposite me. That was all really a preamble to our listed Londoner of the day, who is Francis Mayhew, the managing director of Wilton's Music Hall. Francis, welcome to the show.
Thanks very much for having me here.
So first of all, I just did my best to flog your place to everybody, but for those who don't know it, give them a brief kind of rundown of what it does and what it's like and what it was and what it is, I suppose.
Yes, it's probably the world's last surviving and one of the oldest music halls. And it's just in between Aldgate East Tube Station and Shadwell DLR, so sort of going east of the city. And it's a terrace of Georgian houses. They were built in the 1720s and they had a little music hall parked on the back of them. And in the 1850s, a man called John Wilton came along, took over the little music hall, really was doing quite well, bought up quite a lot of the terrace, in fact, a good chunk of the alleyway, and built himself a big, well, for those days, a very big music hall across their backyards and called it, of course, Wilton's Music Hall after himself, and ran it as a music hall for quite a few years after that, sold it, a few more guys took over, and they had the most fantastic acts, really famous people made their way through there. It was a very early music hall before the sort of larger music halls with the Mari Lloyds, these kind of descendants of these early music halls really made their name. And it continued like that. Interestingly, in the 1880s, it was sold and bought by some very keen Methodists who were looking to clean up the area. And they were very pleased with their new purchase and their new cleaned up little part.
Wasn't it a temperance hall or something?
Yeah, pretty much. They were very keen on lots of tambourine banging and cups of tea and things like that. And they actually ran it as a Methodist mission all the way until 1956. Right. So ironically, it's been a Methodist mission longer than it has a music hall. But obviously a fantastic part of that community there. And then after the Second World War, a lot of that area was either bombed or cleared as part of the slum clearances. And as was that area, and Wilton's was scheduled to be demolished. And narrowly escaped that by a campaign led by Sir John Betjeman and some keen enthusiasts who got it listed. So it's a Grade 2 star listed building, but nobody owned it or no one could do anything with it. And it was just kind of left to fall down, I guess.
Wasn't it a rag store at one point?
Yes, it had some slightly squatting, I think. These rag family moved there. And some people say that one of the reasons why the auditorium roof was saved for so long was because the rags were piled up so high, this is memories from locals going in there, that they couldn't actually see the ceiling. They were packed right up to the ceiling and kind of held the building together when there was no roof, which I can almost believe, actually.
When did it come back as a venue for entertainment and stuff?
Oh, well, I guess it sort of had these little flickerings, these slight little moments, like when the location managers found it for Frankie Goes to Hollywood's Relax.
It was in the Craze movie.
Yeah, Craze movie. So I think the film world got there first. It was definitely had some good location work. And then in 1998, Fiona Shaw and Deborah Warner did this wonderful, really short performance of The Wasteland. And in those days, you know, it was really early site-specific, abandoned venue kind of theatre. And then I'd say, well, we got our licence in 2006. So
who owns it now?
Our trust. It's called the Wilton's Music Hall Trust. And its job is the care and conservation of the building and keeping it open to the public.
So how did you get involved?
So I got involved when I was a student and I was helping out an opera company who had a residency there as an intern. And I'd never seen a building like it in my life. I mean, I did say earlier that I was brought up in Norfolk, so there aren't many things like that. But I genuinely had never felt such an atmosphere in a building before.
And I mean, that is one of the things. It's kind of palpable, isn't it, as you walk in.
It grabs you by the throat.
Yeah, it does.
Very rare, that. A few years later, it was going bankrupt and absolutely falling apart. And I sort of thought, well, I'll go and ask the trustees if I can have a shot at sort of, I don't know, doing something there. I didn't really have a plan at the time. And they said, yep, that's fine. You've got 6 months to pay off the debts. Otherwise, we're all out of here. And 10 years later, I'm still there.
And what is its state now? Is it still perilous? Are things bits still falling off? Or
at this point in time, yes, they are falling off. I got a bit of my skin knocked off over the weekend. But actually, from May, the final round of building work starts. And by summer next year, every single bit of it will be stuck back together.
And is there a danger that in saving it, you could spoil it? Because part of the appeal of the place is that it does feel like it's just, it's almost ethereal, isn't it?
Don't think I don't sweat a lot about this, and I don't lose a lot of sleep. And my whole team at Wilton's, you know, who are, they must be the most careful conservationists in the world. If a little bit of plaster falls off, they just so carefully put it back where it was, because
you don't really want to restore it in terms of making it look new and swanky, do you?
Definitely not. And particularly where we are with so many high rises going up around us, it's so important to keep that character. But that's why it's going to take such a long time. So we're employing these amazing craftsmen and lots of traditional builders to really slowly repair it room by room, putting the beams in and the major structure, all the underpinning that it needs. And then every room is just going to be repaired on a do no more than is absolutely necessary.
I was going to say, will it still have that air of, I was going to say genteel decay, but it's a little bit more than genteel, isn't it? Yeah,
I hope so. I really hope so. We really endeavour to keep everything as it is, unless it definitely is falling apart or somebody's going to fall through a floor. And then we don't need to do any more. So that's it. There's no.
And what's its long-term plan?
So the long-term plan is that it will be a wonderful sort of hybrid venue. It's a great visitor attraction. You can go and learn about music hall. You can visit it anytime. There's a wonderful old pub there, and learn about that area as well, because it's got fascinating history. And then during the day, there will be all kinds of heritage or artistic activities, kids, clubs, that kind of thing going on. And in the evenings, you go and see shows there.
Okay, so it will come back. I mean, it has been a performance venue, but it's been very intermittent, hasn't it?
Yes, very ad hoc. And I really have to thank our local authority for letting us sort of hop along as we have, really. It will be a really exciting venue, I think, because it's such a beautiful space, and it is a bit of the star of every show in some ways. But
I mean, sometimes I guess there's almost a danger that the building can outshine the performance, isn't there?
Yes.
You do tend to sit there looking at the kind of the curly pillars, the candy pillars, rather than who's on stage.
You definitely can. And I know, you know, when the first reviews came out when John Wilton opened it, that there's barely had any chat from any of the reviewers about the artists. And there was a huge lineup on the opening night, and he'd got all the best stars in town and that kind of thing. They're sort of listed by name, and then there's these huge long descriptions of the twisty columns, the beautiful chandelier, what a nice seating arrangement, the good beer, this kind of stuff. And I thought, oh well, nothing's changed, you know, that's no Wilton's. You know, obviously, if you want to, it's the added dimension.
In 10 years of being there, have you ever despaired?
Oh my gosh, so many times. So many times. But
you think it was you were going to fail?
There was a point when I did, and one of the houses was moving away so far that you had to jump over a foot gap to get into it, because it had just sort of moved away, and I couldn't get any funding, and I've been turned down loads of times. And I thought, the next time my local health and safety officer comes here, that's it. The shutters are going to go up and I'm going to have to sort of disappear into a dark corner and pretend I was never there. But actually, but I never gave up hope that people wouldn't sort of love Wilton's, though.
And what finally saved it?
A seed grant from the Foundation for Sport and the Arts, which kind of opened up a whole world of funding to us, including now where we have lottery funding. But really, I mean, that's sort of on a technical level, if you like, but really it was people that saved it, which is so great because it's a people's place. People campaign for it. Our team has sort of stuck by it through thick and thin. So it's definitely the public, yourself, definitely yourself, local media, that kind of thing, have always supported Wilton's.
And can people go along there now? Is there anything on? Is it open? What's the situation?
Yes, you can go there now any day.
Is the pub open?
Yes.
It's a good pub.
It's getting back its old Wilton's character. And you can pretty much go definitely Mondays to Saturdays anytime. And the hall is open most of the time. We're about to open another show tomorrow.
Are you? What have you got?
We've got a show called Father Nandru and the Wolves, which is a lovely story. It's based on a true story of a village in Romania that was the end of Ceausescu's era, and their village was being demolished. And they had to club together with the local gypsies, who they weren't too fond of at the time, to bury their church because they wanted to save it. And then years later, they came back and dug it up.
Well, that's what you can go and see Wilton's. Now, people are already sending me emails saying how much they love it. Ian's just said, I love Wilton's. He says, the best event I've been to was the Child of the Jago fashion show.
Oh, wow.
It was brilliant and so well suited to the venue. The icing on the cake was my daughter meeting her heroine Vivian Westwood there.
Oh, lovely.
So, and I think it is that kind of place, isn't it? You will remember your visits there, I think.
Yes, definitely. It's so unusual and it's nice to be able to do different things there. So you might see a fashion show there. You might see an opera there. You might see a film shoot, but it will always have a Wilton's casing to it.
Well, we're going to find out more about the managing director of Wilton's musical, Francis Mayhew, who is our listed Londoner this week. But first up at 12:30, it's time for the news headlines.
An Italian man living in London, convicted of being a mafia boss, has won his legal fight not to be extradited from Britain. Westminster Magistrates Court ruled that they could not send Domenico Rancadore to Italy because they didn't have sufficient assurances that he'd be treated humanely in prison. The Independent Police Complaints Commission is overhauling the way it investigates deaths in police custody. The review follows concerns that the Commission's investigations aren't thorough enough, take too long, and appear to treat police more favourably. The authorities in Malaysia believe the final goodnight message from the airliner that disappeared 9 days ago was made by the co-pilot. It's emerged that the plane was in contact with air traffic controllers after a tracking device on the aircraft had been switched off. And the celebrity cook Clarissa Dixon Wright, who found fame on television as one half of the Two Fat Ladies, has died at the age of 66. Her agent described her as utterly non-PC and said her fun and laughter would be missed by many. London's weather for the rest of the day, cloudy but dry. It will get brighter towards the east for a time, mainly towards the East End and out towards Essex and Kent. Top temperature, 17 degrees Celsius.
BBC London 94.9, here's the latest travel news, and taking a look at the M4 coming into town between the Heston services and Junction 2 at Brentford. The inside lane is still closed following an accident which happened earlier on today. Still very slow on the approach to this, and you can update us on 020 722 42000 or drop us a tweet at BBC Travel Alert. Now, we've got severe delays in the West End today. We've got some telecoms works on Pall Mall, where one lane is closed westbound at Waterloo Place. That's causing queues through Trafalgar Square, then back onto Whitehall North. Northbound, the Strand is queuing all the way back from Waterloo Bridge. We've also got one lane closed on the Strand eastbound for works right at the top of Waterloo Bridge, so that's adding to the delays. And the Strand underpass is closed until mid-May for maintenance work, which is adding to the northbound delays over Waterloo Bridge. We've also got delays through Piccadilly and Shaftesbury Avenue. So certainly the central area is very, very tricky for the time being. Woolwich Ferry, that's still down to single boat service. That's been the case since last week because of technical problems that keep recurring. Carl Shulton, there's been an accident on the London Road on the A237 at Butter Hill, so do watch out for restrictions and delays to the approach to that. South Harrow, there's been an accident on the Northolt Road on the A312 at Parkfield Road Junction. And Cricklewood, we have reports of a broken down lorry on the A407 at the junction with Rockhall Road. Good service on the tube at the moment. On the trains, expect 25 minute delays on train services through Gatwick Airport. That's after a bridge was hit at Salford, so it's affecting First Capital Connect, First Great Western, Southern and the Gatwick Express. And 15-minute delays for London Midland services between Euston and Northampton and Birmingham. Fiona McKinnon, BBC London 94.9. Next update in 30 minutes.
BBC London 94.9 Breakfast.
Should it be more in London? Because London is so much more expensive to live in.
With Penny Smith and Paul Ross.
There is a case for regionalising the minimum wage. I think that might be a sensible step to reform.
Weekdays from 6.
I'm a great believer in doing the un-British thing and complaining.
How much the best you've done, Jasper?
A brand new car and better version of the original.
Or can I write to you asking for advice about how to complain about you?
You could.
BBC London 94.9 Breakfast.
Do I know names yet, David?
Probably want to give a chance to some of our visitors and some some of our members of the zoo who might want a chance to name them. So, Paul, Penny and Vanessa might be a chance.
You were listening a bit earlier on.
With Penny Smith and Paul Ross, weekdays from 6.
That's the breakfast team. We'll be back tomorrow at the usual time, but I'm here. And so is our listed Londoner of the week, Francis Mayhew, who's the managing director of Wilton's Music Hall. And we've been hearing about the struggle, and I think it clearly was a struggle to save the building. And can we say it's saved now, Francis? Is that definitive?
It's saved. It's really saved. It's really saved.
Was there one day when you sort of thought, that's it, we've done it?
Yes. Last July, when we got the lottery funding, that was the final, like, you know, what it is, thing in the jigsaw puzzle.
Yeah. Were bottles opened? And
bottles were opened. Tears were shed. Really? I cried. I cried for about 3 days. I joke you not.
Right. Well, I hope we can't make you cry in the next half an hour, but we should find out more about you and your London town. What would you say is your favourite neighbourhood?
Well, when I first moved to London, I lived in Camden for many years, and it's definitely my favourite neighbourhood, and I often regret leaving it.
I live there now.
It's just perfect. I think you've got everything there. You can go from Regent's Park, down Parkway, onto Camden High Street. You've got the market, all the buzzing. You can go to the canal, and then you can go see something in the Roundhouse. I just think that's a great little corner of London.
It's changed, as all of London changes, because London seems to be in a constant state of flux. But it hasn't quite got sort of gentrified. There's still a bit of grit in the mix, isn't there?
There's still a bit of dirt there somehow. And I think it's that nice mix that you still got a slightly hippie, almost like a hippie vibe.
Hippie punky kind of something.
Yes,
yeah.
Bit of tie dye still, and the street shops, that kind of thing. It's not too pretentious. But you've got a great variety of things there.
Absolutely. What would you say is your favourite building? I mean, I presume you're going to say Wilton's, but I don't know.
You know what? I'm not going to say Wilton's because I'm going to bring it up later. Okay. I've got one for the exterior, which I love, the Carrera Cigarette Factory by Mornington Crescent. Those big black cats. But for atmosphere, otherwise for me, it's the Church of St. Bartholomew the Great in Smithfield. I've never walked into a space quite like that also grabs me by the throat, the atmosphere of it.
That's interesting you should say that. Let's talk about both of those buildings. So the Carrera Cigarette Factory, also known as Greater London House or whatever that was a cigarette factory, wasn't it? It was where they made cigarettes back in the 1930s and gave it this huge kind of Art Deco Egyptianate building.
It's mad and wonderful and I love it. It's just so romantic and bizarre.
And then St. Bartholomew's over there by Smithfield. Why that one in particular of all London's churches?
Well, I live near there and that's how I discovered it. And I like churches and I like the fact that there's quite a nice thing to do in London is poke around and look inside churches. There's lots of them. And it's very, very old and it's a right mishmash like a lot of these old buildings because it's been bombed and rebuilt and remodeled over the last, 800 years or something. But when I walked inside, there was just something about it that made me feel sort of a bit tight in the throat. And
it's interesting because it is indefinable there, because I would say Wilton's has exactly the same kind of effect on me, as does the one that I mentioned earlier, 19 Princelet Street, which is the old Jewish synagogue
Fantastic
behind the house.
Building.
What is it about places like that? Is it just the accrued history or what?
Yes. I feel like if I'm being sort of straightforward about it, I think accrued history is like that, but I started to get a little bit whimsical in my old age about buildings having personalities and atmospheres and energies, that there's still little voices hiding in the brickwork that come out and that's what you feel somehow.
Some of the voices at Wilton's might have been a bit naughty. Because
they were always naughty.
Because it did have a reputation at one point in its history, didn't it?
It did. Oh my goodness.
Was it a brothel?
Definitely a brothel. In fact, I just read this bit of The Night Side of London by J. Ewing Richard, or something like that, who's written about this poor sailor who goes to Wilton's Music Hall.
Is this a book of the time?
Yeah, from 1858. And oh my goodness, the behaviour he mentions, all these women that are constantly raping the men, pillaging their pockets, getting them absolutely wasted and drinking water themselves and pretending it's gin and making off with all the stuff. And in fact, the poor sailors get so depressed and knocked about that they throw themselves off into the Thames and kill themselves.
Sounds like a riot of a book. Not What's it called again? I must read it.
The Night Side of London.
Right then, that's definitely going to be on my list. All right, we know what buildings you like. What about a building you don't like?
Oh, I really don't like the Shard.
Don't you?
No.
Why not?
I feel like it looks like, the top of it just looks like Sauron from Lord of the Rings, those funny spiky little red eyes at the top. There just doesn't seem to be any imagination about it. It's just a great big triangle.
You see, funnily enough, I quite like the Shard. The one I really don't like is the new walkie-talkie one, which is clumsy and lumbering and heavy.
Okay, I would agree with you on that as well. Yeah, you're absolutely right. That's not really nice building either.
But I'll let you have the Shard as well. You can have any of them. It's your choice and it's your London. Did you fall in love with London when you first came here?
Definitely. I mean, when I first came here, I first went to Wilton's anyway. So I'd already...
Not on your first day.
Yes.
Really?
Well, other than trips when I was a child or that kind of thing.
Right.
But I hadn't really been before.
Right.
So I was 19.
Right.
A student and went straight, got off the train, Liverpool Street, went straight to Wilton's and thought, wow, this is
amazing. It's all like this.
Yeah. Wow. That's really cool. And then I knew, I think, that I was always going to be in this city, and somehow the theatre side of it is so fantastic.
All right. Well, Wilton's is very much an enclosed space. What about your favourite opens? Oh, no. First of all, the best view in London. I missed one.
Ooh, I think it's, if you go to Alexandra Palace and look out from there, from their gardens, it's just amazing. You can really sense that the scale of this city. You can still pick out all the little landmarks and it's beautiful surrounding.
I do that quite regularly because I cycle up there on a Sunday. That's one of the things I do.
Very fit.
It's one of the 10 hills that I cycle up on a Sunday.
Very fit.
But one of the things that always amazes me is how green London is from up there. There's whole swathes, because obviously you're seeing Regent's Park, but you're also seeing lots of the other green bits
in all
directions.
And the trees, and it is surprising. It looks quite romantic, actually.
No, it's a very good view up there. I'll give you that one. What about an open space? Pick one of those.
I like the Rose Garden in Regent's Park.
Why?
I think it smells nice in the summer.
It does.
And it feels just a little bit private inside a beautiful park anyway. You feel like...
And you've got a cafe.
Yes. You've got all the nice conveniences and there's that lovely open-air theatre there as well. But I just love Regent's Park in totality. I think it's wonderful.
Do you get involved in the programming at Wilton's? Is that part of your area as well?
Yes. Mostly all of it. Yeah.
Is it?
And
what sort of stuff particularly works well there, would you say? And is there anything that doesn't work there?
We have had a few things that have... I think things don't work well there if the intention behind them is not quite what it should be and the acceptance of the space isn't quite what it needs to be. But when something's got passion or heart behind it, you can have a wonderful amateur show or a bunch of kids doing something there that is...
It's a very high stage. You wouldn't want it to fall off. It's incredibly steep, isn't it?
Yeah, okay. So you need a bit of stability and those things are wonderful. And music is very good there. The acoustic's wonderful for that. So even if it is a bit off the wall or wacky, I think that's the nice thing about music hall. You kind of get away with a very wide spectrum of art.
Are you a shopper, Francis?
I'm not a great shopper, actually. I don't get that much time
to
go shopping.
Well, you've got to pick
shopping.
A shop.
This was really difficult for me. The place I quite like hanging out the most is Neil's Yard Dairy, where you can try all the different cheeses.
Are you a cheese lover?
I love it. I love it. And you can be so surprised in there. You can just say, I don't know what I want, but can I try a few of these things?
So which one would you go to? Are you going to go to Borough Market? Because they've got one there, haven't they?
For me, it's easier to go to Covent Garden and get the bus there.
Okay, so you're going to have cheese at Covent Garden.
Yes.
Have you been to the cheese shop in Marylebone?
No.
Oh, the best. I think better.
Mm.
I think it's just called the cheese shop. I might be wrong. It's just off of Marylebone High Street. It's not cheap, it has to be said.
Well, neither's Neil's Yard.
No, exactly. And it's very similar to that, but they've got this kind of temperature-controlled cheese room that you have to go
fantastic.
Into.
Fantastic. Sounds like right up my street.
And it's a really good one. I would hasten you to go there and have a look at that or smell at that one because the smell's pretty extraordinary too.
Thank you.
While we're talking food, you need to pick a pub, bar or restaurant.
Yep. Well, just recently I went to the Four Seasons. It's a Chinese restaurant on Gerrard Street and they do the most fantastic Cantonese crispy duck. They really do.
So which one are you going for? The Four Seasons on Gerrard Street. Because everyone should have their own favourite restaurant in Chinatown.
Yeah, really. That's mine now.
Okay, so you're going to go for crispy duck there. Do you get back to the countryside very often?
Not that often, no. Theatre is a very antisocial lifestyle, so I work most nights and weekends.
And do you go to most of the events?
All of them.
Really?
All of them, bar maybe one or two a year. Yeah.
Do you ever get fed up with Wilton's?
No.
Seriously?
Not yet. No way. It's different every day.
One of my listeners, Simon in Tooting, says, it's great to hear that Wilton's will finally be saved. It will always have a soft spot in my heart as I met my wife there.
Oh.
8 years ago.
Oh, that's so romantic.
It was on a night with old record players all set up on stage playing in the middle of the hall. I met my wife whilst drinking some of the house gin in the bar, he says.
Fantastic.
So there you go. You've got at least one.
That's fantastic. I feel like Cilla Black.
Excellent stuff. You're listening to our listed Londoner today, Francis Mayhew, who is the managing director of Wilton's. And I'm going to ask you, well, that was a pretty memorable night out for one of our listeners. What's your most memorable night out?
So this is about Wilton's, actually, and it was seeing Fiona Shaw perform The Wasteland. And it was just absolutely hypnotic and beautiful and freezing cold. And I'll never forget that. And then afterwards, going upstairs to say how wonderful it was to the dressing room and finding Miriam Margolyes there, who then told the most funny jokes I've ever heard in my life. She must be the funniest lady I've ever met. And it was just such a wonderful juxtaposition. I'd had this very serious, intense moment of theatre, and then I went to the dressing room and had these ladies just absolutely ripping apart so many things. And that, for me, is my most memorable night, I think, in London.
Given that the building has been precarious, to say the least, over the last few years, have you ever had nights when you've had to think, oh, no, please don't bump into that column, please? Do you kind of did you stand there kind of getting all nervous?
Oh, my goodness. We've been, sometimes, you know, people have said to me, my team, I've got the most wonderful front of house manager, and actually run Wilton's with my partner, Filippo. And between the three of us, we are like, I don't know, I wouldn't say we're like Nazis, but we're like very paranoid front of house managers. And the number
because
of
we've
times,
all done it. You have, you know, yes, you have a party at your house and someone's about to knock over
the
your...
The worst thing is people and birthday cakes, you know, they always want to light candles and it's like, don't touch
please,
that.
Please, don't, have a candle in here.
Counting people in and out of rooms saying, I'm sorry, but when we say only 30 people are allowed in there, we really mean it. That's not even funny. 31, you'll go through the floor. It's just, yeah, we do have our moments.
It must have been bad for the nerves.
It's bad for the nerves, but also sometimes I feel like we were like, you know, Basil, what's his name,
40,
in Fawlty Towers, yeah. Running around like idiots.
All right, I'm going to give you a day off. You can't go to Wilton's. What will you do?
I would just love to go. I think I'll probably start around Spitalfields Market, go to Borough Market, Brixton Market, and munch all the food that you can get on those, on the sort of street stalls. I love that. And I love the fact that there's so much of it around now. I could happily have gourmet coffee after, you know, interesting wrap endlessly. I'd spend all day just wandering markets.
Okay, so you're gonna, so will that be a weekend then, I guess, if you're going to do all the markets? Or
yes.
Perhaps a weekend. Walking around. Because we do that a lot. I usually start off at Columbia Road and then go Brick Lane, and then sort of go around that way, really.
Perfect.
It is. It's a great way. And it sort of still feels uniquely London somehow,
yes,
I think.
Definitely. The people that you meet, the stuff you see there, it's...
And also that rather lovely combination of sort of old London and new, if you know what I mean. And particularly somewhere like Columbia Road, where you've got all the rather she shops around the side, but you've still got the flower sellers shouting their wares and everything.
Yeah, that's London, old and new.
Right, you've got someone visiting who's never been here before. Where would you take them?
So I would take them out on a Sunday. And in a similar way, I'd like to take them to Spitalfields Market around Brick Lane, walk to Columbia Road Flower Market, take the bus to Hackney Wick to some of those more trendy art galleries.
I haven't been there at all, you know. Is it good?
Stour Space Cafe. You've got to go around all that Hackney Wick area.
Right.
It's very trendy, but it's very cool. And I think what they're doing as their sort of social enterprises is very good. And then I'd take the Overground to Camden to go to the Bartok Bar, bit of classical music in a pub, which I think is quite nice, and then a play at the old Red Lion pub.
What a lovely day. That's all very, very nice. Let's look at the opposite. What's the worst journey ever?
I don't have too many bad journeys. I'm quite lucky that...
How do you get around normally?
My boyfriend drives me around on his scooter, actually.
Oh, really?
That outrageous.
You're on the back of his scooter? Started,
yeah. It's the best boyfriend in the world. And I cycle. Actually, the worst day I actually had on London Transport, I'm sure I'm not the first person to say this, was after 7/7 bombings.
Yeah.
Because Wilton's is right near Aldgate East Tube Station. And that was the most horrific journey home. I walked all the way home. And, I mean, you didn't have a choice, obviously, the way it was, and then getting the tube back the next day was really, it was really terrible, actually.
It was terrible, but I remember feeling, because I was on air, and then I had to walk home.
Gosh, yeah.
I walked home from there. And what I did remember feeling was quite proud of the lack of panic and everything.
Yes, that's
true. I mean, thinking, this is terrible, this is a dreadful day, but I'm quite proud of my city for having such a kind of calm countenance.
Yes,
like.
And then next morning, getting on the Northern Line,
yeah,
and everybody on it, and you knew everyone was thinking the same thing.
But they were still there.
They're still there.
Yeah, no, I loved all of that. In fact, I had an extraordinary example of that. The shop opposite me me as a Portuguese shop. And I went over the next morning to buy a paper. And obviously the front of the paper was all about the bomb. And the Portuguese guy in the shop, and they're fantastic, they're lovely people, still with, you know, an accent drenched in the River Douro or whatever fantastic. It was, said to me, he said, isn't it terrible? He said, but us Londoners, we don't give in. And I loved that. You know, he'd been there half hour, and yet he'd somehow absorbed the whole spirit of that.
True spirit. That's wonderful.
Absolutely. All right, then, what's your personal London landmark? Something that makes you think you're home?
Smithfield Meat Market. Straight away. It's at the bottom of my street.
why Smithfield Meat Market? What are they planning to do to it?
Oh, God knows. Last time I saw something that came through my letterbox, they were going to knock half of it down and turn it into office blocks and some
just
flats.
What we need.
Yeah, exactly. I'm really delighted about that. It's terrible. It's such a beautiful building. And I just, when I finish the theatre late at night and I come back past the meat market, they're just opening it up. It's about 2 o'clock in the morning and all the trucks coming in. And there's a wonderful rapport there and people are buying and selling. And then in the morning when I go to work, they're just closing it all up. I think it's wonderful.
It is. I hope it stays there as well. Yes. So do I. Who's your favourite fictional Londoner?
Well, that was a really difficult question. But just very recently, I read a new book out called Kitty Peck and the Music Hall Murders by Kate Griffin. And the heroine is called Kitty Peck. And
she was on the show, I think. Not Kitty, but the other writer.
She's a really lovely lady. And I was very privileged to meet her. And I really loved her book. And I thought, yeah, that's a good fictional London character.
What's it called again?
Kitty Peck and the Music Hall Murders.
Okay, that's your choice for favourite fictional Londoner is Kitty Peck. What about favourite London film or book or play or whatever you like?
In the end, I've gone for The London Nobody Knows, presented by James Mason. It's a hands-down winner, really.
Wilton's is in it?
Wilton's obviously is in it, with a nice performance on the stage.
So is the one that I would love to have seen and didn't in Camden Town that went. There was an old music hall in Camden Town.
Oh, yes, the Collins.
No, was in Islington. I can't
Bedford?
Remember. The Bedford. It starts in there. There's one part of it. I mean,
it's such a shame
it's gone. That those went. So, yeah, The London Nobody Knows is absolutely fantastic. Is that London that he portrayed still there? Because, I mean, I grew up in this city, and certainly in the 70s, up until the 80s, I think, you could still sense that Victorian England, that Georgian London. Mm. I think you have to work a bit harder now.
You've got to dig a few layers, definitely dig into a few layers. But I think that sense of the change, though, and the people that are coming and going, that hasn't really changed. It's just the way that you look at London now, and some of the industries have changed. Obviously, the architecture's changed hugely. But it's... the good parts of it are still there, I think.
Absolutely. And one of the good parts is definitely Wilton's. If people listening to this have had their appetite whetted and they want to come along and see it, what's the best way to do so? You know, in terms of just being able to see a show or just getting a tour or...
Oh, well, we have quite a comprehensive website, wiltons.org.uk. Give us a call or pop by.
You can't just turn up and expect to go round, though, can you?
Not in the actual auditorium itself, but you can just turn up and see other parts of the theatre.
And the pub's up and running and all that, so you can always go and get a drink and stuff. Okay. Yeah. And then finally, if you could do a spot of time travel in either direction and for as long as you like, where would you go?
I'd have to pop back 150 years. There's a few facts about Wilton's I need to check on. But otherwise, I'd really like to go into the future. I'm so curious about how cities change, how people change, and how some of their cores stay the same. And London is one of the world's great cities. And I'd love to see it in another 150 years' time. I'd like to check Wilton's is still there.
I was going to say, first of all, are you confident that Wilton's will still be there?
Absolutely. We're laying down ironclad foundations.
Are the finances secure now?
Finances are secure as any arts organisation is, probably.
Sure.
But, yeah, we're solid.
And then let's go back then to the opening night of Wilton's Music Hall. What would it have been like? Do you have a sense of what it would have been?
I've got... my memories of a review that I read, and it said it was heaving and full, and it had this wonderful list of performers, an opera singer, hurdy-gurdy player, some impersonators, comic singers.
And would everyone have been dressed up and in their finery?
Definitely sounds like it. John Wilton actually called it concert and supper room to start off with, because he wanted people, a slightly better class of person, to go there. And he'd got different ticket prices so you could sit in slightly nice areas. And in fact, it was so nice you could bring your wife.
Cool.
I mean, that's saying something, isn't it? And it said that the chandelier had 360,000, sort of 36,000 pieces of cut glass in prismatic prisms and spangles.
Wow. You haven't still got the same chandelier, have you?
I haven't. But we know who made it.
Do you?
So maybe we'll be able to find
one day.
It would be very lovely to have that.
Well, if hearing all of this, you've never been down to Wilton's, it's time that you did. Francis Mayhew, thank you very, very much.
Thank you very much for having me.
Don't know when I've been so blue. Don't know what come over you. You found someone new, and don't it make my brown eyes blue. I'll be